Hey guys, this is B-Run, and welcome to another Let's Hack FF6 stream, where I found out that hacking is kind of like most other addictions. As soon as you have a little bit, as soon as you do one thing, you're like, oh, I can do this. Oh, I can do this. Oh, I need to do this. And then you just do more and more and more things until basically it consumes your life and you have nothing other than a very, very narrow skill set to offer to anybody. So we're gonna do some event coding. It is the most specific thing possible that we could be doing. This isn't even Super Nintendo related like our normal coding. This is event coding. This is specific to Final Fantasy VI. But it's gonna be good stuff. And on top of that, we're gonna be expanding NPC sprite sheets. Actually, not just the sprite sheets, we're going to be expanding the total number of NPCs, which was always a thing that we had thrown around but not actually done, but it was really simple. I, like, literally did it today in, like, 15 minutes. So, I'm going to be going through that process tonight, and we're going to be adding Namingway. And for some reason, I'm super hyped about that. I don't know why, I just like Namingway. And then we're going to go through an event with caseword bits. And what caseword bits are, in case you don't know, it's how you can do conditional branching within the event code. So there's something that sets a bunch of bits, and then what you do is you check for those bits to determine whether you're doing this or whether you're doing that. That's all that is. And for my early events in Children of Vector, I kind of avoided those just because I didn't want to have to do the extra, like, walking if you talked on one side and had to go around or anything like that. So I made it very specifically so you could only approach things from one angle, so that I didn't have to deal with caseword events. So I shied away from them, actually, until this week, and then I decided to do one event that has, like, 30. So I'm making up for lost time. And we're gonna learn about that. It's actually not that bad, it's just, if we had a proper editor, it would be awesome. Okay, it would be really easy. The only real issue with doing the caseword events and all the conditional branching is that you have to calculate the offsets for a lot of code. But it's not difficult, it's just tedious. But watching an event come to life is really cool. So that's what we're going to do today. How are you guys doing? I want to know how you guys are doing this week. So speak up, let me know. In the meantime, I'm going to jump in here to the first part of this, which is actually going to be sprite sheet expansion, or sprite expansion. I keep saying sprite sheet, but it's the total number of NPCs. It's NPC expansion. You were awake for 23 hours yesterday. Why did you do that? Why in the world would you be awake for 23 hours straight? Also, hi, Smasher. Good to see you. I am glad you're here. All right, so I've got my ROM up here, and the first thing I'm going to do, and this is probably the only time you'll see me do this, because for some reason, I always keep the header in here. I'm going to take the header out. Okay, I'm taking the header out of this, because once I get to calculating offsets for event code, I don't want to have to do the extra 200 bytes, or 200 bytes, in addition to subtracting CA from everything. So, and you'll see what I mean by that when we get there. Oh man, gotta catch those 4 a.m. flights. Ugh, guess those are the cheapest ones, right? No good. I mean, I'm glad you got took care of everything. I hope it was a productive meeting at least, or meetings, plural, meetings. So hopefully they were at least productive for you. All right, so I went ahead and tracked down all the places that the NPC pointers are called. So first of all, we have this document in the wiki, if you look it up, that is basically a ROM map. It shows you where everything is in the ROM. And if you do find on it for, actually, what is it? It's some kind of pointers. You know, I know where they are, so I'm just going to go find them. I'm just going to go to where they are rather than... Actually, CODOF2. So this is the opposite of the way you're supposed to do it normally. You're supposed to find it in here, and then go, you know, from there you find it in the code. But I did that already. I already did the hard part. But most of the time you're going to look up stuff in here if you're trying to figure out what to do. Hey, Kyuga! Good to see you. We are, we're expanding the total number of sprites that you can have in a ROM, which I think might be something that you would be into since you are, one of our graphical changer uppers. Yes. See? Technical terms. Graphical changer upper. Okay? So, in the original ROM, there's only room for, A4, which translates to, I think, 165 different sprite sheets. Well, I'm going to go ahead and expand that up to 255. So, FF. Alright, so, if you're looking for something you don't know where it is, a good place to start is this FF3 info ROM map that you can get on ff6hacking.com. Go to our wiki page. Or no, I'm sorry, there should be a link for FF3 US documents, and that's where you want to go. And I keep forgetting what I'm looking for here. Where in the world are you? No, CODOF2. Here we go. Pointers to map character graphics. And there's actually two different kinds, which you can see right under here. So there's two sets of pointers. And that's because the Super Nintendo is 16-bit, so the largest chunk it can take at one time is 2 bytes, okay, because that's 16 bits. Hey, Mog! Good to see you. Good to see you. So they had to just split it up into two chunks. Now, there are ways that they can go around it. In fact, the battle pointers are actually just 3, 3, 3, 3, 3, but they load it a different way so that they can work it. But this is the way they did it for the overworld sprites. He's saying yo. Like, yo, B. Because B run, okay? Not going anywhere else with that, just B for short for B run. I thought B run was already pretty short, but that's okay. I'm okay with it being shortened. Everyone calls me B. Although, when I was Edrin, I did kind of enjoy being called Ed. I have no idea why. As weird as that sounds. When I was Edrin, everyone just called me Ed. I was like, okay. Alright. So, we're going to go look at this. So you can see what we're looking at here. So we're going to go to... And I took out the header for anyone who wasn't here then. CODOF2. Alright. So this, it's in 2 bytes at a time. So 00... And then A016402D. Okay, so those are the inside of the bank pointers. And these are going to correspond with something else in here, which is where the sprite sheets are in vanilla. Okay? So you see Terra starts here at D50000. Okay, so the first set of pointers goes to this 00 section, which it's not that. That's not the thing I was going to click on. I was going to click on this thing, okay? So you see that 00? All right? And that's because that is the first one in this set of pointers. Why 0? What in the world are you talking about? Are you talking about W0B? Well, it is leet speak. You know what leet speak is, right? Internet slang? Here. Shoot, I don't remember what P is in... Oh well. Leet speak, okay? Sorry, Kyuga. Sometimes that stuff... Oh, right, S, you can do that for spiak. Exactly. Some things just don't translate well, Kyuga, on a messenger. Alright, so you see that was 0-0, and then the next one is Lox, and his inside bank pointer is 16AO. Doot-doot-doot. Here we go. And you see AO16. That's reversed, that's Endian order. Anyone who's been made it this far in my hacking stream hopefully understands that. But if you don't, bytes are typically loaded in reverse order. So they are still read from left to right, but when they're picked up as a group, then they're kind of loaded in so that when they come out the right way. Has to do with the way the processor handles the data. Like physically, how it physically handles the data. I guess logically too, but that's a function of how it physically works, okay? And then you see the next one here is 402D, which is 2D40. And again, you come up here to Sign Sprite Sheet 2D40. All right, so you see that this is lining up. You get the picture. All right, and then the next set is at D23C. Let's go back over here. And we're going down to D23C. All right, and you see here we have D520, 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 D520. Okay, that's because this is the bank. And this 2-0 has to do with the size of the sprite. Because there are some sprites that are two tiles by three tiles, and then there are some that are 3 by 4. Well, they didn't program it to read it backwards, because this is machine code. Nobody who made Final Fantasy VI did this. For all intents and purposes, we know more about the code than the people who made the game. They wrote in a traditional language. I have no idea what. Maybe they had a proprietary one for coding for the Super Nintendo. But then their compiler converted it all into code. So it's the equivalent of us using XCAS. They programmed everything in a programming language. This is how processors handle stuff. So this is going to be true in basically any processor. That Endian order, that reversed order of certain sets of bits is going to be a thing. All right. So anyway, you see down here. So these are all the bank pointers. So it does lots of D5s, and then there's D6s and D7s. And that's because, again, over here, right here, this is the bank where it's at, okay? D5, 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 eventually goes down to D6, D7. I've got some expanded stuff in there that you should see at 4-6. And then we're talking about those 2-0s, the size of the sprites. If you go down far enough, there should be one or two poking out around here somewhere that have like 3-0, I do believe. All right, maybe I'm wrong about that. I'll have to double check on that. But it's something else that they do with it. It's typically not important for anything that we do. Yeah, I know, which is why what I'm doing is basically crazy. It's basically crazy talk. The level of changes that I am doing to my game. Which is why I have a projected release date of 2188. So, I'm just gonna take my time, do it on stream so I can have fun, and hope for the best. Okay. CUV is living on a prayer. All right. So anyway, that's where the pointers exist. And so now we just need all the places the pointers are called. We need to move those pointers. And what's nice is that we don't have to move the actual sprite sheets, because that's actually the big part of the data. Because these are long pointers that we're doing, they're absolute pointers. We don't have to do anything other than move the pointer lists, because it's picking up the full address, which means all the stuff that's there can stay there. I can put a sprite anywhere. I could put a sprite smack dab in the middle of the C2 bank where all the battle calculations are done, if I had space for it, and the game could process that as long as I put the pointer going there. All right, so this is kind of the premise of us being able to expand sprite sheets. Is the fact that as long as we have the data there and we have the pointer going there, The game knows what to do with it. Yeah, I know, right? I know, right? In fact, I was saying that on the I was saying that on the stream or on Discord the other day, that as long as that my children's children will be finishing this hack for me. So as long as I name one of my kids Vector, then the name will be totally appropriate. All right, so the first thing we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and we're going to move the data to my new location. And my new location, did I just write it somewhere? Here we go. Here we go. So the 4-4 bank, and then 4C00 and 4E00. And so that'll give me room for a full 256 entries on each of those, okay? So we're going to grab the inside bank pointers, which is up here at DOF2 down to D23C, here to here. And we're going to copy that. And we're going to go to, where did I say, 44FC00. And we're going to paste it in there. All right, so I just moved all the pointers here, and then I'm going to change in the code where it's looking for. Was it coded in assembly? All right, well, maybe they did. They had to have had at least a compiler for the assembly. It would have been silly for them not to use a compiler when making the entire game. Like, it may have been the assembly language, but it... I doubt it was in hex like this. But that's good. That's good. That means, okay, so they did know as much as us. Okay, I need to get off my high horse because I like to think that apparently I know everything. Which I do. I just shouldn't flaunt it. Right? Alright. And then going back, D23C. That's beginning of the bank pointers. And that goes all the way down to when those stop. Which I just did that visually. I'm assuming that's right. All right, and those are going to 44FE00. All right, so where originally these were bumped right up against each other. So there wasn't, and then there was stuff after this and stuff before this, so I couldn't make room. So now in all my expanded stuff, I've gone ahead and given it a lot more room so that I can start filling these in. Well, that's true. I still have to deal with some of that stuff. All right. And you see 4-5 here. This is actually where I started putting my expanded sprite sheets when I was when I'm adding more sheets. All right. So that's step one. That's step one. But we need to finish by changing all of these here. All right, so we need to change each of these to the new locations. And I actually already have that in here. And so this, if you guys need this, ping me and I'll post it. In fact, I could post this on the hacking stream megathread on the site. If you guys are interested in doing this, because as far as I know, I'm the first person to act. Well, I haven't seen anyone else do this. I would imagine Tsushi did it, since he had the, but he never posted anything about it. Since he did a major battle sprite expansion for his patch, so I would imagine that he did also, but. No one's ever really posted on this. Alright, so first one I'm going to go to 548D. Alright, and then 00FC44. Next one's at 96BF00FE44. Next one is at 67C2. 67C2. So BF00 FC 4-4, and then one at 9C. Wait. Did I just do that in the wrong thing? C8, 6-8, 9-C. Okay, never mind. I missed one. Hold on. C2, C8. Right here. Okay. Never mind. 0-0, FE-4-4. Okay. So that's me changing. So every time you see the FC, that's the in-bank pointers. And then the FE is the bank pointer, which bank it's in. Catone was doing a massive sprite sheet expansion. He was not expanding the total number of NPCs. And then he was adding like battle stuff to all of them. And then the last part is portraits, which I'm not going to do here today. And in fact, I'm not even going to do the battle sprites today, even though I have done that in my working COV ROM, not this one. All right, so what was the next one? That was 6-7, so I now have to go to 6-8, 9-6. 9-6. To 0-0, FC. 4-4. And then 9C. 0-0, FE. 4-4. And there should be one more set. 6-9, 9-2. All right. And this one, it's actually in three parts. And I think it's because it's 8-bit and 8-bit, yeah, 8-bit accumulator is set. So they have to do 1 byte at a time instead of 2 bytes at a time. So 0-0, FC, 4-4, then A3 is 0-1 because we need to offset by 1 within that first set of bank pointers, or inside bank pointers, FC, 4-4. And the last one's at AF, which takes me there. 0-0, FE-4-4. Okay. All right. So I moved the pointers and I changed all of the calls to the pointers, which means if I did that right, I should be able to go back to where the original pointers were and erase them, and the game will still work. And that's how we do this. That's all right. It's confusing. In fact, I was stumbling over my words when I was talking about it, because for that exact same reason. It's easy to confuse expanding the sprite sheets to expanding the total number of sprite sheets. Because when we talk about expansion in general, we're generally talking about the number of things. Whereas my original video, like 3 years ago, was about expanding the NPC sprite sheets to like full-size PC sprite sheets, which is about changing the pointers themselves. So it's all interconnected. It's all interconnected. All right, so DOF2. And I'm just going to erase all of this because I am pretty confident that this is going to work. And if it doesn't, whoops. But I did all of this this week, so I did all of this once this week, so I should be good. All right, I'm going to fast forward this process. Bing. Actually, how far down do I need to go? Down in there somewhere. All right, that's good enough. That's good enough. No, it's not. I have OCD. There we go. Okay. All right. So assuming I did this correct, then the only thing we really need to check is to make sure that the game works. All right. So let me hop out of here. I want to go into the hacking stream. And you know what? I did have problems last week. I hope I don't have the same problem again. I did have problems last week with running copies of the ROM out of my OneDrive folder because it wasn't updating properly. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go ahead and grab this and this. I'm not gonna move them, I'm gonna copy them. There we go. I'm gonna run them out of here just to make sure. All right, so assuming I did this correct, we will still be able to see things. It will not blow up. What? Oh, I don't have save. All right, hold on. I do have a save state I just pulled up, though, which will fix everything. Alright, let's go outside and make sure. Yep, alright. Well, it looks like my, my sprites still work. Things still working. Things are still working. Alright, see, so all of my sprites are calling properly. Everything works. Alright, so that means it was a success, okay? The success means nothing changes. As weird as that sounds, nothing changing is a good sign here. Because that's the first, that's basically the first step of any hack you do. It's figuring out if you can replicate it so that then you can start altering it. Because it normally means moving it to another place to make sure that it still works. You know, it's narrowing down what are the, what factors are in play here. Alright, so we went ahead and did that. And from here, I'm actually going to close this one. I'm going to open this one. I'm going to open the one that I've got on my desktop because I don't really care about this. This isn't my working copy. My working copy is in here. So I can work from here. All right, so now that we did that, let's go ahead and add Namingway. Because that's all I really need to do today. I'm not going to do any of the battle stuff. All right, so Namingway did a little bit of work on him for my event. OneDrive. And I'm just going to show him to you. I actually don't need to pull this up. I'm just going to show you what I have. Don't crash on me. All right, so this is what I've got so far. I just added a couple more sprites that I hadn't done yet. All right, so that's what I've got, and I'll replace maybe some of these as I need them. But considering he's an NPC, I don't really need all that stuff. I'm just gonna use some of it. Whatever pops up. All right, so currently I've got him in locks position in this copy of the ROM that I've got here. And so now we're gonna be copying the sprite sheet data. All right, so you see that lock is here at D516A0. So in that copy of the ROM, out here, that is my debug copy is what I call it. It's what I just basically do random stuff in. So I'm gonna bring that up here. And I still have my header in this one. What did I just say it was? D516A0. So that's gonna be so this will be 1516. So 18A0. Alright, so that's the beginning of lock sprite sheet right here. And so I'm gonna copy from here all the way down to the beginning of Cyan's sprite sheet, which again going back here, yeah, 16A0. She's gonna be D52D40, so that's gonna be with the header 2F40. Alright. So let's just go down to where 2F40 right there. Alright, so this data right here, this is all Namingway sprite sheet, alright? So we're going to copy this, and we're going to take it into Children of Vector. All right, and so the next place I have space set aside is in 4.6 in the XHIROM. All right, so copy from here. We're going to 4.6.8.0.A.O. And this one I already took the header out, so that's why I didn't have to add any extra stuff to that. All right. And yeah, you see we're right here at the end of my battle Vargas. And we're gonna paste the data. All right, so we stuck the data in. We moved the pointer list to make room and we stuck the data in. And now we just need to add a new pointer. We just add a new pointer to this location here. All right, so if you remember that was at 44FC00. All right, so we're gonna go down here to the first blank spot. And it's going to be A080, right? Endian order. I probably should for later use. But the thing is, some of them are gonna change. And most of them are like old sprite cheats, so I have no problem doing that. Hey, Emperor Excalibur! Thank you for the follow. That was awesome. That was awesome. That was very cool of you. Alright, so we add an in-bank pointer for Namingway, and now we just need to add a bank pointer, so we're going down to the end of the list, and that is in my 4-6 bank, and 2-0 for the, it has to do with the size, but we're just going to follow the pattern, okay? We're following the pattern. Okay? So that adds Namingway to the game. He is actually in there now. And now there's one more step. There's one more step. We have to actually put him on a map. So this is what we're gonna do. And I'm editing the one on the desktop. All right, and this is my special copy of the editor from MadSir, but this will work just fine in anyone else's. It's gonna be a little bit different, and you're gonna see why in a moment. Actually, it's not a little bit different from what you'll see right away, but if you decide to expand your sprite sheets, you're going to see the same thing that I'm about to see. Narskool. So that's where we're going to stick him. And put him in here. And bring up the NPCs, and you see how I've got garbage over here? That's because the editor is looking for the old pointer list that doesn't exist where it's at. Okay, it doesn't pull that dynamically for the editor. But, so that's why it's pulling gibberish right now. Mad, I believe, is working on an update that will allow you to use expanded sprites. So I'm making my Emperor Excalibur, I'm making my own change to the game. I'm actually making what I call a requel. It is called Children of Vector. And it takes place alongside the original story with a different cast of characters. Okay, so I actually have a demo video up on YouTube, and there's a bunch of information about it on our site, ff6hacking.com. And so this is a major hack that changes everything from sprites to mechanics to new maps, new music, totally new event chain. So this is a major over-the-top crazy thing that I'm doing, and it is going to take a long stinking time to finish, but that's okay because I enjoy doing the work. And so I decided to start doing this streaming as kind of a way to help other people that are also doing hacking kind of learn more about the process and maybe become more interested. And people who just like Final Fantasy VI, maybe they come and check out some of the hacks that are on our site, kind of expand their love and their knowledge of Final Fantasy VI in general. So that's what I'm trying to do here today. Oh, okay, right, duh. Sorry, I have a disconnect. I have a disconnect between like things that happen on stream and things that happen anywhere else. And this has always been the case. If I see someone in one place and see someone in another place, it takes a long time for me to put the two together. And my brain just separates things. I'm very good at separating stuff into its key components, but the reverse of that is not true. Putting stuff together that I already see separately doesn't always happen. So you have to bear with me. You'll have to bear with me. So we're expanding the total number of NPCs that you can put in the game. Actually, total number of NPC sprites sheets. There's so many different ways to expand NPCs, it's not even funny. Because you can expand the total number of NPCs that exist in the game, then there's the total number of possible different sprite sheets you can pick from, and then there's expanding the size of those sprite sheets. So, there's a third level now that we're talking about here. I hope I am not confusing everyone too much. Alright, so NPCs, we're going to go ahead and add a new one. We're going to add a new NPC. And I don't want to go grab him, so let me just use the coordinates from the other person. 98, 47, so I'm just going to put 9848 to find him. There you are. All right. So this is Namingway. Doesn't it look like him? It looks like that. I'm really good at spriting. So that's what happens. All right. So that's Namingway. I'm gonna go ahead and drag him over there. I'm gonna leave him always available for now. And he's gonna face the west because he wants to look out and not at the wall. He is not in timeout. And we haven't made the event yet. We're just trying to get him to appear. And we'll start working on the event here in just a moment. Okay, we're just trying to make sure this works, okay? So we save. We save. We launch the ROM, we go inside, and... Oh, whoops, I forgot to change the sprite. But, what a good-looking guy, nonetheless. Hey there. What's cooking? All right. Sprite. 165. Action. I don't care about the action. I want palette. Palette 1. Let's try that again. Hey, Lock Kirby. Good to see you. We're expanding things. It's like, apparently my thing. It's what I do. What? What? Why does he have the wrong palette? I gotta fix that still. Alright, so we got the right sprite. We have the right sprite and the wrong palette. You know what? I think it was because I didn't go onto another field. It did not, or hit enter anything. It didn't save that way. So now let's give that another shot. There we go. There's our Namingway. Alright, so we have successfully added a new NPC slot. A new NPC. And made him pop up. Okay? So that's how you add more NPCs. That's how you add more possible NPC sprites to the game. And now, we're going to go ahead and give him an event. Because he doesn't do us any good if he just sits there. Alright? And I'm going to go ahead and set the address now so I don't have to come back in here again. His event is at... Yeah, I know, right? There's so many things you can add now. Alright, so I'm done with these for all intents and purposes. Namingway 6690. 6690 is where you're going to be. Alright, 6690. Save there. Where's your other thing? And save the ROM. Okay. So, this is the event I worked up for him. And I already did all of the, I already calculated all the branches. And in fact, I will probably copy and paste this from my other ROM. It's really not that bad, and the only reason I blew through it that quickly is because I literally did it, like, earlier today. So, I did all my pre-work this week, which is very rare for me. It is very rare that I go and do everything I'm gonna do on stream before the stream. Normally, I'm just, like, get in and I start winging it. Which doesn't always work. You know, it's actually... It really is not come from, like... Having this level of knowledge really isn't that special. It just comes from just keeping doing new things. Like, I literally just kept going, and there was always just another thing I wanted to do. You know, and so it just kind of started snowballing, and then someone would ask a question about something that I had done in the past. I was like, oh, I know how that works. And so that would come up, and then... and so I don't know everything, you know? There are people that know a lot more about a lot of things than me. But I have the things that I know. And so I try to share those things. And when that stuff comes up, I like to get engaged. So, thank you very much for the compliment. And you can get here too. Really, you can. Most of what I learned about doing this stuff, I learned in about 6 months of doing it in my free time. You know, it really wasn't that bad. But once you've got, like, when you have a drive, like, so I've got Children of Vector, and so I have all these things that I've been wanting to change, like, forever about the game, then it was just, like, as soon as I found ff6hacking.com and other people that knew stuff, it was really easy for me to start digging in, you know? I'd never be able to do this without the disassemblies of CO, CO, C1, C2, C3. You know, I'd never, ever in a million years be able to do that. Now, I'm hoping I'm getting to the point where I know enough that I could take this knowledge to another game and dissect stuff, or another portion of the ROM and dissect stuff. Move about the map randomly. There's a bit to set in LE that is basically just, or it's like it's an action thing, and they just and they'll just walk around. There's it's an action number. That's what it is. Let me show you. Let me show you. Still on the desktop, right? And yes, I will take this opportunity again to say, if you guys have any questions, I love answering questions, even if they're not about what I'm talking about. Action number, yes. So, Figaro Outpost. One of the maps that I made. I've got a guy out here that's walking around. And you see his action is 3. And so that has them just kind of wander around. So action number 3 is the wander. Okay? That's what it is. Action 0 will have them just stand there. I honestly don't know what all the actions are because I haven't had to find them yet, you know? As soon as I have something that I need it to do, then I will do it. What do you have in your pocket, Lock Kirby? Should I ask? Yikes. Talk about an expansion pointer. Oh man, the jokes. I can't do that. Gotta keep it family friendly. All right. All right, Namingway. All right, so I'm just going to walk through what I want the code to do. Because this I kind of pieced together from a couple different things. And I don't have it up right now, but there is actually an event script that has all this stuff. Oh, man. Yes, that is a brand new map. I made that. Oh yeah, and the LE can you can expand your map space by moving all your tile maps off to a new location. Again, which the new editor automates the process for you. I actually had to do it manually, which was fun, let me tell you. I spent a whole day doing it. But yeah, so the new LE that Madseer put out will automate that process for you, and then you can start adding new stuff. So again, check on our site. It's in the Matchtech Research Facility, which is our general hacking section for FF6 on the forum. So there is an ongoing thread. It should be up top because I believe that's the most recent thing that's been going on in there. All right, so just walking through it real quick. First thing we're going to do is we're checking to see if there's... I've got a bit in here set because his intro, I only want him to do it once. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to check to see if we've already run this, if we've done this before. So if we've done this before, he's just going to jump to the end where he starts asking me if I want to rename my characters. All right. So if it hasn't done it, then it's going to go ahead and set the bit. And this is where casewords start. So we're going to load up the subroutine to set the caseword for the direction the party is facing. Because there's two places I can approach him from. Because he's up in that little corner, I can approach him this way or this way. So for you, I guess, you looking at me, I can approach him either from the bottom or from the left. All right? So because of that variable, if I'm going to do any kind of movement or any kind of action, then I want to normalize. I want to be in control of that, you know? So what I decided to do was if you're talking from underneath him, you'll move around to the left of him, and then the scene will continue as normal. So that's what we're doing here. Okay, so this subroutine right here, and this is in vanilla, so all you have to know is just set that to set up the certain bits for you. Okay. And so the very next thing I do is I check a bit and branch based off of it. So what this bit is checking, it is checking to see if bit 0, which is looking north, is clear. If it's clear, it branches, okay? So that means if they're not looking north, then it'll skip to the rest of the intro. Okay? So this CA66AC, which is right here, I believe. Okay? And that means if that bit is set, that means the party is currently looking up, which means they are approaching from the bottom. And so we go ahead and we move left, we move up, and then we turn right so that we're facing him, and Namingway will turn to face you, because when you interact with him, he'll automatically turn towards you. So you walk around, then he turns back. Okay? And now we're ready to start. So, should I start with that? Should I start with that much? I don't know if you guys want to see this incrementally. It is 10:16, so we actually do have a little bit of time. I'm trying to figure out how much to copy and paste in here. Because most of the work for eventing is planning, okay? Very little of what you do is actually in the editor. You want to do most of it right here and have it planned out. So I would like to come up with a better format that shows all of the parameter bytes that go into these. But for now, I just copy you straight from the event script text. Now, if you either are having a hard time searching for something in there, and I should pull that up. Hold on. Event script. Okay, so this has all the events in vanilla. Okay. In a sort of disassembly. Okay, so what I did was I basically would copy certain things and I was pasting them into a document to keep track of everything. Okay, so that kind of got me my structure. And once you've got the structure, you just build it out. You do what you need to do, okay? And it starts to flow. Like, once you get going, because it's really just reusing a lot of the exact same commands over and over again. And what's nice about this, as opposed to doing something in, say, ASM, is that there's very one-to-one association between what you're putting in and what you see happen. Okay, whereas with ASM, there may be a lot of calculations, there may be a lot of things that go into a certain effect that you're trying to have, and it looks like a very small change. Eventing is the exact opposite. Everything you put in does something. And so it's really nice to see. Eventing is one of the most exciting things to see happen in a hack, because it is actually coming alive. All right. So this first thing that we do is we'll approach from the side and we come up and he goes ahead and he'll say his first thing. And so instead of putting all that in for you, I think I will just go ahead and I don't know how much you guys want to see about eventing. I'm more explaining how these casewords work. Actually, you know what? You guys tell me. Are you guys interested in seeing me plot out some of this stuff? What it looks like to translate this into pure hex? Because this isn't the whole command, you know, or this is rather the command, but it still needs the parameters. And so there are a lot of those. Are you guys interested in seeing how some of that works? Because there are nuances, especially with checking to see if a bit is set or if a bit is clear, where it uses only certain bits in a byte. So what are you guys most interested in seeing? Do you guys want to just start seeing stuff? If I do that, I can plow through this pretty quickly. Okay. All right, Kyuga. So why don't I go ahead and I'll do the hex here just for this first bit. All right. And so we see we've got So the first command is co. This is always going to be the first byte of the command. And the first thing we're checking here is if this bit is set, okay? So the way this is set up, this always says the same thing. You don't really don't need to worry about this. This is the offset for where event bits start, where the event RAM starts, okay? This is actually what you're looking for. This is the specific identifier for the bit we're checking. And then this is the actual location it's at, okay? Is 1E81 bit 7 is the actual bit we're checking. But this is the identifier. This is really the important part. The rest of this is notation, really. So this is the thing you need to keep track of when you're going through these. So we've got CO, OF, and again, see, we're doing this in that endian order. I'm going to turn my caps lock on. And then it would normally be 00, right? It would normally be 00. And this is where I told you some of the weirdness comes in. Not really weird, but you see that there's only one extra digit here. And it's because this other digit in this byte, it's going to use to check for other information, okay? So in this instance, and I don't think there are any other ones in this particular command, is we're going to check to see whether it's set, and the very same command can check to see whether it's clear. And so in order to change whether you're checking to see if it's set or it's clear, is you're going to set that high bit. You're going to set that high bit. So if I have COOF00, I'm going to be checking if event bit 00F is clear, okay? But if I change this to 80, it is now checking to see if event bit 00F is set, okay? And the reason that that is 8 is because if we are looking at it in the calculator, hex for 0 is obviously 0, right? Now, if a byte is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 bits, okay? And you see that gets us to FF. That is a total full bit, or a total full byte. Okay? So if we only need to set one bit here, and we are starting with 0, and we're using most of those bits to determine what the identifier is up here, if we set just that highest bit, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, you see that translates to 80, but is just turning this one bit on. That's all we did. We turned that one bit on. Okay, and so that bit right there, that bit in this third byte here as part of this command, says to check whether the byte or whether the bit is set rather than clear. Okay, so now what this reads as, if 00F is set, that's what this says. If 008 is set, or 00F is set, and now we have the branch location, okay? And again, this is going to do that reverse endian order. It's not reverse endian, it is endian order, or reverse order. Reverse endian order would just be a double negative and regular. So don't let me confuse you, because that's generally what I do. All right, so the full command for that portion of the script is that right there. So if byte 00F is set, go to CA66E8. All right, the next part is to set the event bit, and that's really easy. Just DOOF, okay? And in the event of setting and clearing bits, it's got a different, it actually has a different command byte for every time you go up one of these. Okay, so if this was 1OF, instead of DOOF, it would actually be D2OF, okay? Because DO is set for 00 through FF, or I guess 000 through 0FF, and then D1 is the clear bit for 000 through 0FF. All right, so then 2 picks up with 100. So if this was 10F, we would be using the D2 command, but we're not. We're using D0 because this is 00F. All right, so that's how you set a bit. So the command, check if 80 is in. So the command C0, the command C0 is checking for a certain bit, and if it is, if this is zero, this, just this part right here, if this is zero, it's checking to see if it's clear, if the bit is clear, and if it's an 8, then we're checking to see if it's set. Right, exactly, and yes, and I do actually have instances of that in here as well. Okay, you see some of these action cues say continue processing, and I added that. That's actually not in the normal script. I just like to have it in there. And this one says wait until complete, and that works exactly the same way. And you're going to see that. That's going to be a pattern with event coding. In fact, that's actually a pattern in a lot of coding, is that there's a bit that is set for a certain thing, and you just need to know what it is and how to make it show up. And the easiest way is calculator, okay? Because the default Windows calculator has a programmer mode that does all of these conversions automatically for you. Okay, because I can go from binary to, what is that, octary? I don't know, I've never used that before. To decimal to hexadecimal. Octdecimal? Octdecimal? I have no idea. Octesian. Octavian. There we go. We'll go with Octavian. Okay. All right. So if you want to know what it is just to set a specific bit or set of bits, then use it and set it up in the set it up in binary and find out what the hex is. But yes, Kuga, that's exactly how that works. All right. So that's how we did a conditional branch. And then we set the bit, and now we're going to do this subroutine. Subroutines are really easy. B2, and then the address. 64CACA, because remember, we're doing that endian order. Is it octadecimal? Yeah, one of these things is not like the others. All right. So anyway, subroutines, going to use those a lot, trust me. Really simple, B2 and the address, 4-byte command. All right, and now we're going to do another one of these. So based on what we just did up here, now we're going to do this for 1A0, and you're going to see how this works again. So C0 for the command, A0, which is the low byte here, and now we've got this 1. Okay, we've got this 1. So we need 01. Okay? Right? And now we're taking this part right here and we're like, okay, we're checking to see if it's set, or are we checking to see if it's clear? We are checking to see if it's clear, which means we need that bit clear, which means this is going to stay 0 in this instance. Okay? See, Kuga knows the song. All right, so now we're checking to see if bit 1A0 is clear. Okay, so now we're checking to see if they are not looking up. So if they're not looking up, then we're going to go ahead and branch to the next part, which is AC66CA. Okay? All right, so we have done this much so far with that much hex. Next is we're going to go ahead and do an action queue, so when you do action queues, you're starting with the identifier of the thing that is doing the acting. Okay, so when you have 0 up through OF are your static player characters. Or end guests, I guess, that are assigned to the actor slots. So that's Terra, Locke, Cyan, Edgar, Sabin, etc. And then your guest characters, if they are currently set up and acting, such as Leo or Kefka in certain instances, who is not a guest actually in your party, but is a guest in terms of how the game interprets the character. For this stuff. So that's characters. So if you see anything that starts with 00 through 0F, that's what that is. 10 through 2F are NPCs that are set up in the map, or if you they can be defined in code, but those are your NPCs. Okay. And so that means there's a maximum of 32 NPCs that can be used at any given time. And then 30 is the camera, because the camera moves independently. Okay? Or can move independently, rather. And then 31, 32, 33, 3, yeah. 31, 32, 33, and 34 are your party characters. Yes. Oh, right. Good call. Thank you. I would have messed that up later. Is 00 because this is a relative offset. Thank you much, Kyuga. Yeah, so, Emperor, if you're still following and trying to grasp this, and this is another thing, and maybe this is starting to be, like, a lot of different things, but when you're doing branches and jumps within event code, there's always an offset of CA, so it's always a relative jump to, based off of CA0000, which is where events start. Okay, so CA0000. I didn't need to do that. All right, so where we had there 66E, oops, E8. If I were to subtract that, I end up with 0066E8, which is really, really straightforward when we're just working with CA, CB, and CC. But once I get out into expanded stuff, which I actually do right here with the second half of this. Yes. Yeah, you did help. Thank you, Kyuga. Then it starts to look really, really weird. So for instance, later on, I'm going to be using the FA bank. And so FA ODEO, I think. Is where I start that second part. Yeah. And you subtract that from CA0000. Now, when I'm putting in my offsets, it's going to look like 30ODEO, which looks nothing like this. Nothing like this. And then it gets even stranger when you reverse that, because it looks like EOOD30. Okay? People aren't going to look at this, for the most part, are not going to see that and think this. Okay, so sometimes it starts to feel counterintuitive, which is why at the beginning of my stream tonight, I took the header off. Because once you have the header, then you're adding another 200 to everything, which would make this F. Which would make that F. So EOOF30 is now the jump to FAODEO. All right, so that's why I took the header off, which I don't always do. No problem, Lock Kirby. You just missed the secret to life, the universe, and everything. And I don't mean the book. It's true, man. It's true. Adding that extra 200 is a pain. It's actually not a pain. In regular coding, it's automatic for me for the most part. But once you start doing event stuff, it is too much. Is too much. So I will say again, we need a proper event editor that can handle expanded space, basically anything you want. I mean the question. You missed the question. You missed the question to the life, the universe, and everything. What was I saying? I totally blanked. All right. Yeah, we need a proper editor that that can handle pointers, jumps with something similar to XCast, where you can just set it where you want it to be and it'll calculate it for you. And be able to use X Hi-ROM. Those are my only requirements. and then put it, I mean, even if it's not totally in plain text, I don't care. In fact, it doesn't even have to import it into the game, I don't care, as long as it translates it for me, and I can just copy and paste it. Is that the only one that requires the header? Is that the only editor that requires a header? Honestly, I don't even know why I still have it in there sometimes. In fact, every time I send Matt a copy of my ROM so that he can work on the editor, the level editor, at least when that was constantly going on, he always sent it back to me without a header. I have to keep putting it back in. Alright, so anyway, we're going to go back to this action queue. Alright, so action queue. So 31, and now we're taking, next thing we're paying attention to is how long it's going to be and whether we're waiting for it to complete. All right, so how long it's going to be is 4 bytes, which is going to include the end queue identifier. All right, now, similarly to the way we were checking to see if it was set or clear, there's also a few different things to pay attention to here, okay? So whether we're going to wait for the action to complete before it continues reading the script, or whether you see later, I see there's a continue processing one, which means this will all happen while the next set of stuff starts happening so that it happens simultaneously, okay? So if we want it to wait until this action is complete before it reads the next line, then we're going to set that high bit again, all right? So 3184 now says party character 0, the first party character, your party leader, 4 bytes long, and wait. Wait until it's complete before it continues reading the script, all right? And then the next couple things I got in here are real straightforward. 83, 80, CD, FF. Okay? And all of these you can pull out of a bunch of things. There's a command list document that I pulled down from the site. And I also have a list of things that I just copy right in that I use all, you know, for action queues. Just because it's easy for me to find right here. Okay, but you can get all of these out of just the regular event script if you have a copy of that, which again, you can get on the site. So this isn't some like secret that I'm keeping from everybody. This is an actual thing. All right, so this stuff just goes right in there. All right, and so now it's telling us that was 4 bytes long, 1, 2, 3, 4, and it was, all right, it was. So we got to the end of that, and now we're gonna do an action for NPC 616, which is Namingway in that map. All right, and it's only gonna be 2 bytes long. And we're gonna wait again until complete. And so we're gonna do 82. And then the actual things that he does, CF, FF. And last but not least for this portion is we're going to go ahead and we'll do 4B, 6100. Now, we're not going to get into it here today, but the display dialog messages also have, and this one has multiple bits that you can do that have different effects that also work the same way. But for the purposes of this stream today, you only need to worry about just not any of them. So 4B to display message 0061. Okay. And I did not set up what he says ahead of time, but I'm gonna go ahead and put that in anyway. And for now I'm going to add a return there because this will jump there if there's a thing set. All right. So let's go into here. And let's go to the location that I want it to go to, 6690. Uh-oh. A6690. There we go. Oh, shoot. I still had the other thing in there. Hold on. Copy that. That was close. I'm just put Namingway sprite sheet right in the middle of the event code. But it would still work if I put a pointer looking at it. All my events would break, But Namingway sprite would work if I set a pointer looking at it there. Oh, we've got people of all different age ranges. It means you're ahead of the game. That's what that means. It means you're ahead of the game. It means you learn all this stuff long before I ever learned it. I did not learn this stuff until, actually, I didn't start learning serious hacking until about 5 years ago. And at that point, I was already, like, 26. In fact, I was probably 27. It was probably only, like, 4 years ago. But yeah. Now I used editors. The first tiny bits of hacking I did was back in college. And that was... So I was already... I think 18 or 19 when I first started. Oh, Q, there you go. Man, see, I'm making puns I didn't even know I was making. I did not even know I was making them. Real quick, let's make sure that... Set... Oh, right, because I don't have that going anywhere. So that'll fail, that'll break. But that's okay. E8. Let's go down here to E8. There we go. I'm just gonna add a return here where that's supposed to go because I don't feel like, I'm not filling in the rest of that right now. All right. And then the other one actually says AC. Let's clear go to AC. Did I not update that in? Because AC goes here. Oh, right. Because that's actually the first thing that happens. He is going to still say his first line. Right. So that actually is the right place for that to jump. Okay. All right. So it looks like my jumps are correct. We've got all this here. I'm going to go ahead and save this. And I'm going to go ahead and put his dialogue in real fast. Actually, you know what? I'm not, because I'm going to actually, after this, I'm going to switch to my working ROM and just start showing it to you after I walk through some of the stuff. Well, that's way earlier than I did, Lock Kirby, so you're still way ahead of me. Still way ahead of me. All right. Hey, and you still have time to learn ASM. Honestly, sometimes I think, Lock Kirby, that you hang on to the fact that you don't do ASM as like your, I don't know what it is, but it's like a thing with you. Like, I think deep down you actually would like to do it, but you don't because it's your thing to have been around so long and not done any. That's what it feels like to me sometimes. All right. 14. Hey, man, there's a lot you can do. There's a lot you can do with just USME. In fact, if you're on a Mac, there's actually a new editor out, FF6 Tools by Everything, that is basically ME on steroids. It is better. It is better in just about most every way. I haven't been through all the things, so I'm not sure if it does quite everything that it does, but it does do a lot of the really big stuff. Plus, it does map and events, and it does eventing like this, but I don't have a Mac because I don't have a Mac. That's all I'll say about that because I don't want to start any flame wars. No, man, ASM is cool once you do a few things and you see something that you're trying to do happen, especially if you have to just pick at it a little bit, like if it doesn't work the first time, but you figure it out. Oh man, that's the best feeling. That is the best feeling. There is a new tool that just came out, a new editor that just came out on Macs, that is better than ME for all the whatever things it does. I'm sure it does better than ME. I'm not sure if there's anything ME does that it doesn't do. I don't know. But most of the editors are on PC. So... But there are tools. There's ways to do, because obviously I'm on a PC. Obviously, I don't. You can't see that, but I'm on a PC. And I can do everything just fine. But I would. There are certain editors that I would like to have, but most of them I just need to poke someone hard enough to get them made. So, just like, hey, make this for me. Hey, do this for me. Hey. That's my way. That's how I solve problems with things that are beyond my ability. Is poke people until they do them for me. Yes, I am on Windows 10. Actually, yeah, you saw my calculator and all my other things. That obviously looks like Windows 10. Never mind. All right, so I copied that in. I'm not going to worry about that. I'm actually just going to go ahead and pop it up. And we go right here. So you're going to see I should walk around to the front, and then he'll look at me. Thieves have been terrorizing the vicinity. Stay away from them. That's not what Namingway is supposed to say, but I haven't changed that in here. All right. And so now you see, if I try to interact with him, it does nothing. Okay, because we set that bit, right? Remember, we were talking about the very first thing it did was it was checking to see if a bit was set to determine whether it was going to branch or not. And since we set the bit, now it thinks that it's done the intro and it's not going to do that part again. Okay, so now later that will actually all go into other stuff, but right now that's all it has. All right, but if I load my save state and you see that walking around to the side, so like that part right there, doesn't happen, obviously, if I'm here. Okay, so here it jumps right into where it displays the text, all right? Now, I'm actually starting to run a little bit short on time, so I am going to show you the whole event, but I do want to talk about these. Okay, so I set up a different section all for this. I did set up a separate section all for this. So I'm going to close both of those, and I'm going to open my actual working copy of the ROM here. All right, and so I'm going to FA0DE0 because it's not F in this, it's 3. There we go. All right, so this is this. Okay? And so just walking through the logic here, we have a one byte command here. That is load the caseword with characters in the current active party. So the caseword, and I mentioned this earlier, is basically certain bits that get set up by various ways that give you information that you can use to branch, that you can use to branch to different parts of code that, so that you can dynamically do things rather than having everything so static and set in place. Okay? Where do I have thing. So if I've got my event bits here, and this is another document you can get on our, probably on our wiki, and this is all of the event bits and the RAM they go to and what they're used for in vanilla, and I've started editing this one for Children of Vector. All right. But you see, that first caseword that we loaded was this one right here. And that was, we were checking to see if we were facing up, right? Okay. So that is caseword bit 0. Now, this is also used in a lot of different things. Okay. Oops. Did not mean to hit that. All right. So this is also used as to signify Terra in certain things. It's used, the next one signified Locke, Cyan, Shadow, Edgar, Sabin, Celis, Strago, Realm, yada, 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 yada. Okay. All right. So there's this one byte command that they wrote that is DE, and it's just by itself, DE. And what it does is the current active party, your four-man party that you've got, it will turn off all the bits that for the characters that are not in the party, and turns on all the bits for the characters that are in the party. Okay? So because of where we're at in production, I literally only have characters 0, 1, and 2. Alright, so you won't see like a weird mix in here right now. But what it is these got turned on. all of these got turned off. Okay, so when we do this DE command, I keep jumping over to the wrong thing. All right, and so now we've got all these casewords, or all of these conditionals. Okay, so we're checking to see if it's clear, and this is the same thing we were just doing. All right, now that the caseword's set up, it's just like any other, it's just like any other RAM bit. Okay, so all it's doing here for the rest of this is I'm following this same structure over and over again, checks to see if it's clear, if the bit is clear for that particular character. If it's clear, it means the character's not in the party, and it jumps down to check the next character. Checks to see if that character's in. If it's clear, skips. Checks to see if it's clear. If it happens to be set, then it goes ahead and runs the stuff before it continues on to the next character, okay? And then what it's going to do, what I've got is dialogue saying, do you want to change this character's name? And now indexed branching, which is another way we can fork stuff. Okay, this B6 command. If you have, and there's nothing special you have to set up in the dialogue, when you have the dialogue, let me show you something real quick. Children of Vector. Dialogue. This is not where I want to be. Where are you naming way? Where are you naming way? So if you look at these here, there are these commands that appear inside the dialogue. So this one right here, anytime you see something in the little angle brackets, is a identifier that the dialogue command used to represent something. So A0 here. A0 represents Wedge's name, or in vanilla, Terra's name, okay? And then if you have these angle brackets, and I hope you guys can see that. I don't know if you can. If you have the angle brackets with a C, that means choice. I'm assuming that means choice, okay? So if you set these up in here, if you set up these choice brackets and then some sort of text that fits on a line, it'll automatically create the little, yes, thank you. It'll automatically create the little arrow that you can move between stuff. All right. And then based on where you hit the A button, that information is loaded up somewhere. And so this next command here takes advantage of that. So it's index branching based on our dialogue selection. All right, so this, just like our B2, remember our B2 up here? It was real easy. It was just B2 and then the address, right? Well, B6 is, since it's just got multiple choices, is B6, address, address, okay? So if we're doing this, it is B6. And then choice one. So if they say yes, it goes to F1, OD, and 30, which we talked about that earlier, why that's 30, not FA. And then the other one, F5, OD, 30, okay? And so I've got that right there in the code. That's how you do branching for yes, no's, or whatever other, like true, false, or I don't know. Or the opera song selection. I was going to try to remember exactly what the words were, but I just couldn't. It just blanked. It's late, okay? It's late. All right, so you see this here, this B6, F1, OD, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I've got that right here. All right, so that goes ahead and runs the index branching. So if you say yes, that you do want to, then it does the name change screen. And make sure that the screen comes back from the name change screen before it continues on to the next character. If you say no, it goes right on to the next character. Yes, thank you, oh my hero, and I'm the darkness. You'd think with as many times as I do it, I just pop it out. But it just doesn't happen. Alright, so that exact same structure I literally just did it a million times. All right. So since we've got the caseword set up with that DE command, since we've got the caseword set up so that it tells you exactly who's in the party, then the only people that it'll run the script for is those people. All right. So now, going back to my working ROM. And you guys get to see the rest of the event here, because most of it's just flashy, and you can look up your own stuff to see how all that works. It is, like I said before, it is one-to-one. What you put in is what happens, okay? All right, so let's go ahead and watch the event, and then we'll see how those casewords work out for us, okay? So, greetings and salutations. My name is Namingway. I travel the world bestowing new names upon those dissatisfied with the ones they already possess. A name is a valuable thing. They are not simply what you are called, but also who you are. What say you? Won't you try a new name on for size? Alright, so now we're about to go into where it's checking for the casewords. So my current party is, Wedge, Vix, and L'Oreal. Okay, and it doesn't matter what order I have them in. Wedge, Vix, and L'Oreal. Alright. So, new name. So, the first person to check was Wedge. Do I want to rename Wedge? Sure, we'll rename Wedge. Name Wedge. Bob. Vix. Well, obviously. No. You will never see me do that. Never, ever. And you know what, we'll just skip L'Oreal's name. And you see, it didn't do any of the other characters because none of them are in the party. Right? If ever you find yourself in the need of a new you, remember the name Namingway. Alright? So now, we talked about that intro, right? So now when we go in and we talk to him, doesn't matter where we are, he just goes right into, what say you, won't you try a new name on for size? So if I say no, he skips all the checking and just goes to, if you ever find yourself in the need of a new you, Namingway. Okay, but then I can keep doing this. Would you like to change Bob's name? Yeah, because Bob is stupid. And your name is Wedge. Vix's name, no. L'Oreal's name, no. And that's exactly how we put Namingway into the game. All right, from start to finish. From start to finish, all right? So quick recap. We started with moving our NPC pointers so that we can make more room for more NPCs, okay? Then we grabbed the sprite sheet we wanted, we put it in the data somewhere, went back to our pointer list, and added a pointer for that location, okay? All right, so that says that our sprite sheet that we put in, now we're looking at it. Now you go into LE, you go ahead and put the character somewhere, assign the correct sprite, give it the right color, that puts our character in the game, and then you start creating your event. Then you start creating the event. Yeah, and don't forget in LE, you also set the event number for where their event starts. All right, so within the events, we talked about bits, how to check them, whether they're set or whether they're clear, how it's the same command, what those significant bits are to change for those commands. We talked about, we talked about branching for that. We talked about how to set the bits. We talked about, we talked briefly about action cues for characters, which is how we accomplished the things that we accomplished. And then we got into a little bit with the caseword. How to set that up. So in one instance, we called it to see what direction the party was facing. And in another instance, with another command, we set up the caseword to what the current party was. Okay, so we used the same bits, but they were set up for us by using either the subroutine or by using the DE command that set them up in different ways. Okay, so using that information, we were able to branch and do the things that we wanted to do, All right. And that was enabled us to do everything that we did here today. So everything from zero to Namingway being able to rename all the characters. That is literally A to Z what you do. Okay. So this will be going up on YouTube because I did not have any random disconnects today. So if you need help with this later, this will be a great reference for you. Okay. So look for this on YouTube. Check out some of our some of the older streams on our Let's Hack FF6 playlist. We've also got a few other streams that are in there that are not on the playlist, but some great stuff that people have done with music hacking, with creating events. Madseer's even done that, and I believe he's planning to do a stream of his own in the near future. Another one. So there's a lot of stuff. There's a lot of stuff. And it is hard to believe that I've been doing this for almost 6 months now, and I have not run out of things to stream. Like, every week, if there's something new. Incidentally, I don't know what I'm gonna do next week yet, but we're gonna figure it out. Alright, so, thank you guys for coming out. I hope to see you next week, and I will be on the forums. Check out our full roster hack that we're getting started on. It's a community project. We're going to be adding two new full-fledged characters. Be on Discord because we can chat it up and just chill and be friendly and also talk random Final Fantasy VI stuff. And if not any of that, come back here. We will see you next week. All right, guys. Thank you so much for coming out. I had a great night. I hope you did too. Happy hacking. See y'all later.